Welcome everyone. Audrey is a legendary critical voice in the world of education and technology. Audrey's articles are widely read, she's highly cited, she gives rousing keynotes, writes books, and conducts painstaking analysis of education markets and finance. She does all of this while operating as an independent scholar and journalist. The reason we've invited Audrey here today, as many of you will know, is that she has a new book out from MIT Press called Teaching Machines, A History of Personalized Learning. Welcome, Audrey.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. This is actually, I think, my first official book reading, which does mean I'm going to like open up the copy of my book and read it to you. I don't have any slides, so if you are, like so many of us, completely exhausted by having to stare at yet another Zoom presentation, know that it's totally cool if you tab out and work on email or whatever you want to do while I tell you a story. Like, I'm not going to know, and I have nothing to show you, so feel free. But before I tell you a story from my book, I do want to give a little bit of context and background, both related and unrelated to teaching machines. First of all, and I'm sure that this will be mentioned when certain people in EdTech read my book, the book is really a history of EdTech in the early to mid 20th century in the US. And that context is important. One of my arguments, and not just in the book, but throughout my work, is that context is really important to technology. That is, we have to look beyond just the tech itself, right? Hardware, software, apps, internet, like none of it emerges fully formed out of nowhere, like from the ether, right? Like Athena born from Zeus's skull or something. Context matters. And the context of the US, I think, really matters then, the time period that my book looks at, but it matters now, right? It matters that these technologies that we're dealing with today are emerging, not primarily, but overwhelmingly and funded overwhelmingly from Silicon Valley. That matters. So I've read a lot of histories of education technology, no surprise. One does that when one writes a book. Well, some people do that. I did that. And in the introduction to Teaching Machines, in, I think, very academic fashion, I kind of lay out what are some of the problems with the way in which we tell the story about EdTech. I think academics, as I'm sure you know, they love to position others' people's work as somehow insufficient in order to make their own work seem more important and groundbreaking, even as a non-academic, right? I know the rules of the game. I don't really name names and point fingers in the introduction and say, that is a terrible book, with the exception of one book, and in particular, a video made by Sol Khan of Khan Academy fame. And I think that Sol Khan really exemplifies the hubris of tech entrepreneurs who assume that their ideas are earth-shattering, that no one else has ever even noticed that there's a problem, let alone come up with a solution. And of course, the solution is the software that they're peddling that'll fix things. And so Sol Khan, while he was promoting his book, The One Room Schoolhouse, he made a 10-minute video entitled The History of Education, in which he offers a very quick, 10-minute sketch on the history of education in the US. He doesn't clarify that. That culminates, no surprise, with Khan Academy, right, as sort of the pinnacle of history. Like, all roads lead to Khan Academy. That is his work, right? Posting short videos on YouTube, offering multiple choice quizzes, is sort of this breakthrough in personalized learning that we've needed ever since the advent of public education. His history is terrible and it's woefully inaccurate. And I was pleased, I suppose, that MIT Press, considering that Sol Khan is an alumni, MIT Press didn't seem to care, although some of the reviewers were like, "Ooh, why are you picking on Sol Khan?" Anyway, I digress. I'll spare you the details and the US history lesson today. And I actually want to talk about another book that I happen to have with me, right? Never Mind the Laptops by Bob Johnstone. And this book, unlike mine, unlike most actually, is not entirely focused on the US. Rather, much of it is about Australia, about the very first school one-to-one laptop program in the world, which, as many of you probably know, started in 1990 at Methodist Ladies College, an independent girls' school in Melbourne. And I recommend the book. Not sure if you're supposed to do that while you're talking about your own book, but there you go. Particularly if you know little about the history of edtech in your country. And don't get me wrong, I love this book. I love this book in part because I think it examines the constructionist bent of edtech, a path that has really, despite a lot of people's hopes, has not been followed in the US, right? Constructionism, to review your memory, is the theory of learning developed by MIT professor Seymour Papert. As the name suggests, constructionism draws on the early work of Jean Piaget and his work of constructivism, that is, right, learning occurs through the construction, reconstruction of knowledge rather than through the transmission of knowledge. And for Papert, learning is most effective when the learner constructs something meaningful. And the most powerful way to do that, Papert argued, was with the computer. Again, Never Mind the Laptops, great book. But it does one of the things that I call out in the introduction to my book, To Teaching Machines, as sort of problematic. That is, it tells the history of edtech as if teaching machines, the devices, not the book, were supplanted by computers, right? As if once the technology moved in a certain direction, that the beliefs and the theories and the practices behind teaching machines were supplanted as well. Lots of books do this. In fact, I would say almost all of the histories of edtech do this. They catalog one technology after another, right? They're sort of a list of technologies. Kind of implying that this progress, this technological progress, means that tech and the teaching and learning are getting better. And I'm not sure that that's true at all. But they also imply, and I think that perhaps unintentionally Johnstone did this, that somehow constructionism supplanted the learning theories that undergirded those pre-digital teaching machines, namely behaviorism. I don't think that cognitive science supplanted behaviorism either. That's more the conclusion of my book than the introduction. But you know, chapter one of Never Mind the Laptops is titled Guided by Pigeons. It's a chapter, as you might have guessed, about the work of B.F. Skinner. And if you know my work, you know that I'm a fan of pigeons. Not so much a fan of Skinner, but I'm a fan of pigeons and what they, I think, represent for edtech. But Johnstone then traces the development of teaching machines through Skinner. But he ends his first chapter by kind of pronouncing that programmed instruction, that is the practice associated with teaching machines, had largely disappeared from schools and was soon to be replaced in the 1960s, already in the 1960s, by this growing demand for computers. And furthermore, Skinner's theories of behaviorism were replaced with cognitive science, he infers. And after the first chapter, neither Skinner nor behaviorism are mentioned again. And that means, you know, he's telling the story of the first one-to-one laptop program in Melbourne, so I'll let it slide. But it's a pretty common thing, I think, that happens when we talk about ed tech, the history of ed tech. It's the setup in, like I said, almost all of the ed tech histories. Skinner appears in chapter one or maybe chapter two, but then that's it. He's gone, right? His ideas are gone. His machines are gone. They've been replaced. But you know, I look around and I see behaviorism everywhere, right? Like I'm that kid in that movie, The Sixth Sense, you know, I see dead people. Like I see behaviorism everywhere. And I think if Skinner was foundational, and almost all these books seem to agree that he was, that means that somewhere along the way, we demolished that foundation and then rebuilt it. But I don't think that's true. I think that behaviorism is the foundation. It remains the foundation. And what we've done is we've built upon it. Not just the ways in which computers teach, but the ways in which I think we even think about teaching and learning and cognitive science. So I want to read an excerpt from the first chapter of the book, chapter one, which, like everyone else, deals with B.F. Skinner and his teaching machine. In the fall of 1953, Harvard psychology professor B.F. Skinner visited his daughter's fourth grade math class at Shady Hill, a private school in Cambridge, Massachusetts, where he observed the teachers and students with dismay. The students were all seated at their desk working on arithmetic problems written on the blackboard as the teacher walked up and down the rows of desks, looking at the students' work, pointing out the mistakes she noticed. Some students finished the work quickly, Skinner reported, and squirmed in their seats with impatience, waiting for the next set of instructions. Other students squirmed with frustration as they struggled to finish the assignment at all. Eventually, the lesson was over. The work was collected so the teacher could take the papers home, grade them, and return them to the class the next day. I suddenly realized that something must be done, Skinner later wrote in his autobiography. The classroom activities violated two key principles of his behaviorist theory of learning. Students were not told immediately that they had an answer right or wrong. A graded paper returned the next day failed to offer the type of prompt and positive feedback that Skinner believed necessary to modify behavior, that is, to learn. Furthermore, the students were all forced to proceed at the same pace through the lesson, regardless of their level of ability or comprehension. This method of instruction provided the wrong sort of reinforcement, Skinner argued, penalizing those students who could move much more quickly, as well as those who needed to move more slowly through the materials. A few days later, Skinner built a prototype of a mechanical device that he believed would solve these problems, and solve them not only for his daughter's classroom, but ideally for the entire education system. His teaching machine, he argued, would enable a student to progress through exercises that were perfectly matched to her level of knowledge and skill, assessing her understanding of each new concept and giving immediate feedback and encouragement along the way. It was a primitive machine, Skinner admitted, fashioned out of a rectangular wooden box. Problems in arithmetic were printed on cards, he explained. The student placed the card in the machine and composed a two-digital answer along one side by moving two levers. If the answer was right, a light appeared in the hole in the card. He built a second model in which a student manipulated sliders bearing numbers 0 through 9 in order to compose an answer. In another prototype, the student turned a knob after setting the answer. If the answer was wrong, the knob would not turn. If the answer was right, the knob would move freely and a bell would ring. A ringing bell is associated with some of the earliest and most famous experiments in behavior modification, namely those of the Russian physiologist Ivan Pavlov. Pavlov had published his research on dogs in 1897, describing how he'd conditioned the animals to respond by salivating, work for which he would later win the Nobel Prize in medicine. Skinner's own research was, to a certain extent, built on Pavlov's, moving from what was considered the classical conditioning of involuntary responses, stimulating salivation with food, for example, to operant conditioning of voluntary ones. By using operant conditioning, that is, by administering rewards or punishments, all sorts of behaviors could be manipulated. Skinner argued not simply reflex responses, and these behaviors could be bolstered through Schedules of Reinforcement, the title of Skinner's 1957 book, co-written with colleague Charles Furster. Although Skinner insisted that he and Pavlov were studying very different processes, the Russian scientist was incredibly influential on the early science of learning in general, focused as it was primarily on animal rather than human behavior. For Skinner, studying learning meant studying behavior and vice versa. For me, he wrote in his autobiography, behaviorism was psychology. Skinner contrasted this with mentalism, a belief to which he would frequently accuse his fellow students and professors of ascribing. By mentalism, Skinner meant both Freudianism and Jungian analysis, that is, ideas about the consciousness and unconsciousness, ideas that had gathered rather popular support, not just among scientists in the early 20th century. One could not observe or verify what happens in the mind, behaviorists like Skinner's contended. Therefore, the mind could not really be examined through scientific experimentation or inquiry. Indeed, in reviewing Carl Jung's book, Psychological Types, in 1923 for the New Republic, behaviorist John Watson, arguably the best known American behaviorist before Skinner, dismissed the work of the Swiss psychoanalyst as, quote, is relying on unjustified and unsupportable assumptions, on magic, not science. Scientific study, behaviorists insisted, meant analyzing activities, behaviors, rather than speculating about inward motivations or sensations. Let me skip ahead a little bit. Skinner described his approach as radical behaviorism, which he argued does not deny the possibility of self-observation or self-knowledge or its possible usefulness, but questions the nature of what is felt or observed or known. Rather than the mind being beyond scientific inquiry, Skinner argued that one could actually examine events that take place in the private world within the skin, but do so through a behaviorist lens. Skinner's commitment to behaviorism was not simply academic, a term that is often used to suggest a theory divorced from practice. Skinner was a best-selling author, a public intellectual, a visible scientist. He was the inventor of psychological gadgetry and a promoter of what Rutherford has called a technology of behavior, a technology that, despite Skinner's rather controversial reputation, has become a clearly identifiable component of life beyond the laboratory. Indeed, Rutherford argues that Skinner's most enduring cultural legacy is his technology of behavior, rather than his experimental science or his philosophy of radical behaviorism. And that is the legacy that is foundational for education technology. It's not where the story of teaching machines begins, but it's almost always where the story of teaching machines ends. Deeply intertwined with Skinner in his psychotechnologies, it's the foundation from which education technology has never entirely broken. So I'll stop there. I do go on about Skinner at length, I'm afraid. Rather than disappearing after chapter one, he appears in almost every chapter for the rest of the book, which I don't know, maybe that's not a selling point to you. I try very hard to not make him into a caricature or a villain. But I hope that by the time we get to the conclusion of the book, I hope that I've made it clear that the shape of EdTech today, not just its theories, but some of its business practices, right? This terribly exploitative and manipulative shape is in no small part due to Skinner's continued influence. So let me just read a few pages of my conclusion, and then I'm happy to answer any of your questions or, you know, entertain comments in the form of a question, whatever suits you. Teaching machines may then be one of the most important trends in the 20th century, both in education and in technology, precisely because they were not a flash in the pan, as some scholars have suggested, but a harbinger. Their ongoing influence can be found in the push for both personalized technologies and behavioral engineering. But teaching machines' most significant legacy might be quite broadly in the technocratic culture that they helped engender in education. That is, Teaching machines were not merely aids to teaching. These machines, as Eugene Gallaudet argued in his report from the very first Teaching Machines Conference in 1958, are a theory of teaching. And I think that that theory of teaching is absolutely what EdTech is about today. It is fundamentally about behaviorism and Skinner's behaviorist beliefs. And I think that I go into this more, you know, in the rest of the conclusion, but I think we have to kind of face up to that legacy and not try to deny that B.F. Skinner is foundational to the field and some of these other behaviorists that I talk about as well. Despite the decades, I think, the decades since Skinner's work, that foundation is as solid as ever, right? Despite the advances in the technology, the advances in the science, I really do think that EdTech is dominated by behaviorism. And I hope that my book makes the argument for why that matters, why Skinner mattered, why he still matters. And I won't spoil it here, but maybe what we can do about it, what we can do about behaviorism and teaching machines, how we might dismantle that foundation, and how others, particularly in the civil rights movement, in the student movement in the 1960s, actively worked to dismantle what they could of the teaching machines of their time. So let me open it up to questions for it from you.
Thank you so much, Audrey. I wanted to ask as well, because you really delved into the history with Sidney Pressey and Ben Wood and all the letters that they wrote to each other during this time. And I think that that's so valuable. So if you wanted to talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, so thank you. Yes, I had an amazing time in the archives at The Ohio State University, where Sidney Pressey's papers are. He's generally seen as the inventor, credited as the inventor of the first teaching machine. Skinner gets a lot of credit. Skinner begrudgingly would say, well, Sidney Pressey did it first, but he did it wrong. Ben Wood, whose papers are at ETS, Educational Testing Service. And then of course, Skinner's papers, boxes and boxes and boxes of Skinner's papers at Harvard. And it was fascinating. I think it was fascinating, of course, you know, to read the correspondence between many of the academics of their time. I mean, these are names that, if you're familiar with sort of educational psychology, you could see a sort of very active community of scholars thinking out loud in letters to one another. And there were also, particularly in Skinner's papers, because he was such a well-known public figure, he had a lot of letters from the public. He got a lot of hate mail, you'll be shocked to learn, but from other people as well. Temple Grandin, for example, who I'm not sure if you're familiar with. She's an activist scholar. She writes a lot about autism. She wrote to Skinner when she was an undergraduate student. Skinner was in close correspondence with members of the Kennedy family, for example. And so it was really fascinating to get this glimpse into the way in which ideas were not just formed in scholarly work, but the way in which they were formed and defended in the personal work. And then, of course, the ways in which Skinner and Pressey and Ben Wood, another figure, really struggled with the corporate side, the business side of education technology. And so, I mean, I think for me, now that as I look to what my next projects might be, and as I look to sort of the importance of this work of documenting EdTech history, I'm of course super curious what this looks like today. We don't write letters, and most of us don't write letters, and I don't know that we save things. I don't know that we archive things the same way in which work work was archived when it was paper. I mean, you can, but I know that I dump a lot of emails into the garbage can and empty the trash to make them go away. There isn't, you know, I think about how in the future people will reconstruct this moment, even, you know, thinking about the history of the year plus of pandemic teaching. What kind of personal documents do we have? We might have the official documents, but what kind of personal communication will we have in the future?
Thank you. It's so fascinating. David, did you have the questions that you want to ask first?
Yeah, there are a few that have come through the Menti portal. So thank you, everybody who's been asking questions there and leaving comments. I will share those in a moment. I wanted to prioritize some that we received even before the presentation, which is great. This is one from Simon, who's in the audience. Hi, Simon. I'm going to say it was from you because you signed off as being Simon in the question. So it says, I greatly value the historical context you provide to understand how EdTech has emerged, especially adaptive platforms and the emptiness of some of its rhetoric. But while most of us would agree that Skinner and behaviorism had deeply objectionable elements, the robust research evidence is that when used skillfully and ethically, intelligent tutoring systems lead to more efficient mastery of core knowledge and skills. That's an important part of learning, but clearly not all that's needed for a holistic education. So my question is the educational research on the effectiveness of adaptive learning tools evidence that you're happy to recognize? And if not, can you please explain why?
So there are several ways in which I'd like to answer that question. Thank you for that question, Simon. I'll start with another story. So over the pandemic, like many people, we adopted a puppy. And like, she's a Rottweiler, so she's a big dog. And I wanted to make sure, as the human companion to a big dog and a dog that people, I think, have a certain idea of their behavior, I wanted to make sure that she was well-trained. And so we hired a trainer, we worked with a trainer. And of course, training the dog was really an exercise in behaviorism, in operant conditioning. And indeed, one of the articles that Skinner wrote at the highlight of his popularity, I think it was published in Scientific American, was on how to train your dog. And so, you know, rewarding Poppy, giving Poppy immediate feedback, immediate positive feedback when she did the right thing. And less about punishing her, right? Skinner was very adamant that punishment isn't the way to train a pigeon, train a dog, train a student. That you use positive reinforcement. And here I was working, finalizing the book with my rage against the teaching machines and sort of reenacting a lot of Skinner's work. And it's very effective. I mean, I think that that's the trick, that's sort of this tricky piece with behaviorism and with behavioral engineering. Which I think we see a lot of today, is that it works. It not, perhaps not 100%, perhaps not always effectively, perhaps, but I think it's pretty effective. My dog, she's a good dog. She's not here right now. She'd be very thrilled to hear me say it. She's a good dog. And I think that that's one of the things that to think about. Of course, you know, then the, so sure, yeah, behaviorism, effective, yay. But also my dog is very different than how I think about other humans and how I think about students. I'm willing to curb my dog's freedom, autonomy, curiosity, self-expression for the sake of my sanity, for the sake of safety, for the sake of other people's comfort, for the rules of society. That's really different, I think, you know, behavioral engineering my dog is very different than behavioral engineering other people, and particularly behavioral engineering at the sort of scale that technologists and educational technologists kind of imagine, that Skinner even imagined, right? Skinner wasn't, as I said, Skinner wasn't just interested in how do I improve my daughter's math in fourth grade, or even how do I improve her class or her school, but really how do I transform the whole system? And in his novel, Walden 2, really, how do I transform the world? How do we use behavioral engineering to change the world? And that's pretty similar to the fantasies, I think, of a lot of tech entrepreneurs today. Certainly the fantasy of Mark Zuckerberg, right? How do we engineer the world a certain way? And I think that changes the stakes. It changes the stakes politically. No matter what the research says about how effective it might be, it changes the stakes politically. And so, you know, I don't know that I would necessarily agree that intelligent tutoring systems or adaptive learning are better, faster, more efficient. I can't remember exactly what the question was, but I think that in some cases, in some circumstances, in some classes, with some teachers and some students, they do work better. But I don't think it's as incredible as a lot of the proponents like to make it out to be. The flip side of that, I think, is what gets lost. What gets lost when we prioritize a mechanistic behavioral engineered orientation towards education. And I think at this moment now, in particular, that it's important for us to think about what are the ways in which we have less individuals working one-on-one with a machine, and how do we work on building more community? How do we work on building more social interactions? How do we work on establishing compassion and care for one another? Not just how do we fine tune the pace at which someone moves through, you know, first year calculus. To me, that's not the interesting or important problem that the world faces right now. And I talk a little bit about that in the book, particularly, as I said, when I look at the civil rights movement. In the US in the 1960s, Patrick Moses was very interested, the SNCC, the civil rights group, were very interested in seeing, could they use teaching machines, could they use programmed instruction to help with literacy, to help with adult literacy in Mississippi as part of some of the activism that they were doing. But I think that the activists actually came to recognize that what was more important was the community developing knowledge, the community working in together to build what mattered to them, rather than being given programs that were engineered and designed by other people. And so I do think that a lot of these issues, a lot of these questions about the politics of education are just as important as any of the research that we might have about how effective it might be in certain other ways.
Thanks, Audrey. We will have time to open up to a little bit more discussion in a moment, but I want to go on to some of the other questions that are in Menti there, and that we received beforehand, without getting into the weeds. One of the other questions that came on early, it's a little bit, perhaps a little bit of a leading question, but it says, is politics broken because education has failed society, or is it vice versa? Are we in the education community suffering the consequences, or do we cause it?
You know, this is such a hard one, because I think when we talk about brokenness, I think that this is such a familiar refrain among the tech and ed tech entrepreneurs that I'm always really hesitant to sort of embrace it, because when they talk about education being broken, they really want to sell you their product. That is, of course, the fix, the quick fix. And, you know, I think that our institutions, many of our institutions are deeply flawed, unsurprisingly flawed, right? They're built not just on the foundation of B.F. Skinner in the case of ed tech, but they're built on the foundation of, I think, white supremacy, for example. The education system, in the US, it's really so fundamentally wrapped up in questions of white supremacy, in questions of capitalism, in questions of exploitation, and violence even, that it's sort of, I'm not sure that, I think that we do really have to address how the history, I think, of our institutions. It's not really, I mean, it's such a deep structural problem that it's sort of hard for me to come up with like a, you know, the five point plan on how we fix it. But I do think that they're so deeply intertwined, and that's why I think it's important to really look at the foundation, really examine the history, and not sort of pretend as though the history doesn't matter. I think that that's, again, that is so common among sort of the Silicon Valley, that sort of Silicon Valley ideology that I talk about in some of my other work, is this idea that the past doesn't matter. You don't even need to know about the past. In fact, the more you know about the past, the more expertise you have in a subject, the less likely you are to be able to fix it. So I do think that the history really matters. And I think that, I don't have an answer other than that.
No, that's totally understandable. I mean, it works. They interact with each other. It's not like one causes the other and the other.
Right.
It's sort of,
right.
Yeah, it's not a simple question to answer. I'm going to share my screen a little bit and just share some of the other questions that have been coming in. So here's one that actually asks about other psychological models. So while behaviorism is dominant in your research, did you come across any alternative psychological models that informed other kinds of ed tech, or were you just sort of focusing on?
This is a great question. And I do a thing that probably made me the most nervous when I was writing the book. And I was like, man, people are really going to kick my ass for this. So let me back up a little. So, I mean, I think that most people posit constructionism and constructivism as these sort of alternative psychological models. I think that that's commonly how we think of things in ed tech in particular, that you can, and you can think actually of Seymour Papert's work, in which he made it sort of clear himself that on one hand, you have this model of computer and assisted instruction in the 1960s and 1970s, in which he said that the computer programs the child, or you had his ideas in which the child programs the computer. And so I think that that's often seen as the alternative way of building ed tech, the alternative way of thinking about teaching and learning with machines as well, a construction of knowledge rather than being programmed. I make an argument, and this is the part where I'm like, ooh, people are gonna be pissed off. I do kind of poke a little bit at Jerome Bruner, at Papert, at some of these ideas that came along and that sort of put the stake in the ground and said, we're different than behaviorism. Behaviorism is old hat. And I have to imagine, I didn't find it when going through Skinner's papers, but I have to imagine that some of the faculty discussions at Harvard were a little heated, right? If you had, you had Jerome Bruner and Skinner, like they didn't seem to like each other very much. Of course, and then you also had, I think Timothy Leary was in the psychology department at the same time. So I don't know, maybe they were amazing. Maybe the faculty meetings were amazing.
I think they would have been fascinating.
Fascinating, yeah. And so, but I do think that, I don't think it's sort of as easy to say that, you know, we just turned the corner, we just flipped the page, and behaviorism doesn't influence us any longer. I mean, I think in some ways, cognitive science did sort of say, now we're paying attention to the mind, which was certainly a break from Skinner's insistence that you can't know the mind. But a lot of the things really still seem to have this sort of, I think, certainly undercurrent of behaviorism in them. One of them, and this is where, I don't know. Yeah. One of them, I think, is one of Papert's most famous inventions, which is, of course, the Logo Turtle, right? So this was, Logo was the programming language that Papert and some of his students invented so that children could more readily program computers. And the turtle was this little robot that you could give instructions if you're a person of a certain age, like myself. Perhaps you worked with Logo when you were younger.
Interestingly, sorry to interrupt there. My nieces are 5 and 7, and they use it in school.
Yeah.
And they have little robots that they program. So it's still,
I mean, I think that this is sort of, this potential alternative, but you would do sort of like forward 10, left 90, forward 10, and you could have the Logo Turtle would move around the geometrically in the way in which you programmed. But of course, that's a behavior, right? That the way in which Papert imagined that a child could sort of gain the epistemology of math was the sort of embodied way of seeing math through the behavior of a robot. And so, I don't think it was simply a cognitive, it wasn't simply cognitive, it was still connected to sort of seeing the behavior and understanding learning by understanding behavior. I guess that's a long-winded answer to this question. But yeah,
isn't part of the issue that behaviorism works really well? Like it works for what people want it to do. It's sort of.
I think that is one of the challenges. I mean, that is this reason why I Silicon Valley likes to pretend as though it's invented everything new. And so you have a lot of professors at Stanford, for example, who are working on behavioral engineering, behavioral economics, but they often don't even use that behavioral piece in there. They don't trace it back to Skinner's work. But the kinds of nudges, right? That's another Richard Thaler's idea of nudge. These are all very popularized ways. Our phones do this to us all the time with the little push notifications, this little insistence that we click on something, that we open the app, that we respond. I think that we can see behaviorism in so much of the technology, not just the education technology, so much of the technology that's used. And it's because it does seem to get us to respond. You know, behaviorism is how casinos are designed, that they elicit from us certain behaviors that are desirable for those who are doing the engineering. And those who are doing the engineering of applications, want to sell ads. They want us to click on things. They want the metrics to learn to look a certain way.
I'm gonna mark that one as answered for now. I'm just going to skip back up to this one. How can we create a space for good socially conscious teaching in the current corporate ed tech environment?
This one is so hard. I mean, I think that this, and then particularly, you know, during the pandemic, I think it's been incredibly difficult. And I think for professors who sort of saw themselves as doing something different from, I think, a lot of the corporate ed tech, the professors who were still the resistors to the learning management system, for example, the professors who had I think to find oneself having to adopt some of these tools and having to adopt some of the corporate tools, because that's how we get to be together, right? Zoom, for example, you know, Zoom has a lot of problems. All of these tools, I think, have a lot of problems, particularly in the ways, again, that they engineer. They want certain behaviors from us. They shape us in certain ways. They restrict what we can do, and they make us, they shape in which the ways in which we can interact with one another. And so it's incredibly challenging. It's particularly challenging in a moment where it's much more difficult for us to say, we're not gonna have it online, right? I'm not gonna post anything in the learning management system because damn it, you'll get the paper syllabus when you come to class kind of attitude. And so I think it's hard. I think that there, you know, for me, that there is still glimmers of political, not just technological, but political possibility in some of these technologies. And I think one of the most powerful technologies is the web. And the web is certainly now as much of a corporate billboard as anywhere else. But the web itself, I think, the original idea, the original academic idea, the idea for sharing research, for sharing scientific research, we do have, I think, the ability, a possibility for students to be able to sort of have their own space, to be able to interact with one another in spaces that are not covered with analytics and ads. But I think it's incredibly challenging. And I think even with something like the web, I think that there are still so many inequalities, I think, really baked into a lot of these things, that it is very, very challenging. And even more challenging when you're constrained, when you don't have an option other than to use the learning management system, when it's decreed that you have to use online test proctoring tools. Both whether you're faculty or a student. I think it's incredibly challenging. But it doesn't mean that the corporate ed tech will win. People fight back. People resist. They always have.
Ashley, did you have any questions of your own that came up out of that there that you wanted to pose to Audrey now?
Well, it was actually about the proctoring, because I was reading your work about that. And then, so it's interesting that you had gone into it, because I just thought, what does this mean for the future? Especially right now, we're in lockdown. So many students are forced to be proctored. There's no other option. And so, yeah, that was my question. I know is that your plans for your next research project?
So I'm not sure what I'm not sure what my next research project is right now. And if you read the book, one of the things, I know it's Skinner again. One of the things that Skinner invented was an air crib, in which he sort of famously had his second daughter placed in this crib that he designed. Anyway, so I'm really interested in technologies of surveillance around children, which does impact, sadly, connect to the online test proctoring. You know, I think that the popularity of online test proctoring is one of those sad examples in which, you know, it feels, and certainly the testing companies like to say that this is inevitable. Like, what else are you going to do? We have no other options but to use this incredibly exploitative and really kind of a pretty awful software. What else are you going to do? But I think the positive, like, this is actually then a moment to say, well, we'll show you. There are other ways in which we can assess one another. There are other ways in which we can build, as the earlier question asked, build a kind of learning environment, build a learning environment that is purposefully very different from the traditional classroom, which even in its sort of analog existence has a lot of problems, right? It's still in certain ways really built on the idea of watching students. You know, so much of what we do is about this deep distrust that we have for students. We don't trust them to be honest. We don't trust them to keep their hands to themselves. We don't trust them. Well, I guess in the US, somehow we trust them to not breathe on one another a bit. I digress. But we really just fundamentally don't trust students. So how do we build a classroom? How do we build a learning community in which actually trust is the foundation rather than distrust, rather than having all of these systems that must surveil and monitor and control students? How do we build practices, teaching practices, assessment practices, community practices that are really built on respecting one another, believing in one another, and trusting one another? And that's not just a different set of technologies, right? That's a different way of teaching. That's a different way of learning. That's that analog or digital. That's a very different way of thinking about what happens in a learning environment. But certainly I think that the test proctoring companies want to tell the story, and it's a story that I think is very familiar, that this is what testing looks like. One of the things that I look at in the book with Ben Wood, who I mentioned earlier, is the way in which, you know, standardized testing, the way in which the history of testing itself sort of leads into teaching machines. Teaching machines are built on testing machines. And again, it's one of these sort of foundational elements of education technology. And I think we recognize the history of testing. We recognize that standardized testing, for example, was deeply intertwined, and intelligence testing were intertwined with eugenics, that they have this really troubling racist history to them. And yet that's foundational to testing. That becomes foundational to automating the grading of testing. And that automation becomes, I think, foundational to what we imagine teaching to look like. And so, you know, we have at least a century of undoing and dismantling that. But this is our opportunity, right? And I think that is one of the things that we should seize in this moment. If nothing else, is that things are such a friggin' mess right now that perhaps we can get away with more. Although, you know, on one hand, we're being monitored even more closely. On the other hand, maybe not so much. But I think that this has to be a time for experimentation, because what we're doing isn't working, and what we've been doing hasn't been working. And so how do we experiment? But how do we experiment not just with the latest technology because it's cool gadgetry and that's what we're somehow told is, you know, that the future must be more technological, rather than thinking about what are the technologies that get us there, thinking about what are really our beliefs, what's our belief system, and how do we build practices that support that belief system? And then the tech should come out of that. The tech shouldn't come out of merely tech for tech's sake, right? Again, that's this importance of context, that we have to be thinking about what are the beliefs and practices that matter to us. And for me, what I want education to look like, I want education to look like a practice of freedom, right? After bell hooks. Like, I don't want education to look like something that's punitive, something that's engineered, something that's controlled, something that's manipulated. And building, you know, if we have education as a practice of freedom, that means that the technologies are going to look very, very different, and they certainly aren't going to look like Proctorio. Education as a practice of freedom is antithetical to the testing, to test proctoring companies, particularly Proctorio.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And the other question I had, I was reading about how the grabs, like in the history, everything that was published in newspapers, the people that were interviewed worked for Encyclopedia Britannica. And so I just wanted to ask you a little bit about that because I found that very interesting.
So I have to say that when I was writing the book, almost it would have been obnoxious, but you have to imagine when you read it, if you read it, when you read it, right? Almost every paragraph, you have to imagine Audrey sitting there thinking, and that is exactly what EdTech is like today. Because if you look at a corporate publication, like we'll say EdSurge, for example, or the Rolodex actually of almost any journalist has the sort of same people that they go to when they need a spicy little quote to fill in the blank to sort of say the things that as a journalist being objective, you're not supposed to sort of say yourself. And so I think you'll often find that people who are cited in newspaper stories today are actually very closely tied to a lot of the products, their investors, their friends of a friend. The networks around EdTech are very tight and very powerful. And so in the book, the chapter that looks at the encyclopedias, so teaching machines were sold alongside encyclopedias by door-to-door salespeople. And these corporations, the encyclopedia companies, were able to sort of get pilot programs in schools. Again, sound familiar? But the people who would be cited were almost always the same people. And then after some of these teachers, principals, superintendents sort of gained notoriety by their successful ed tech pilot, lo and behold, suddenly a year or two later, they would find themselves with a job at the company, which I'm sure I don't need to name names. We can think of many people for whom that similar sort of arc works today.
Thank you. But I have to say the biggest thank you because your work is so important and it's so important for us to be educated about this instead of everyone having blinkers on, because I think people do get excited about the latest technology, but we have to remember that we're human and that we need to be proper teachers.
Thank you. Thank you. That means a lot. I mean, I think, you know, working on a book is a bit like working on intelligent tutoring systems is a very isolating endeavor. And it's great to actually have the book in people's hands to see other people reading it. Cause when it's, you know, that's the difference I think between being a teacher and a writer. When you're an educator in the classroom, when we're together, we get the response from one another, that sort of human response and that energy that we get from one another is really intellectually and emotionally, I think, gratifying. When it's just you and the blinking cursor, it's kind of dreary. It's difficult. And so I'm thrilled that the book is in people's hands and that people are reading it and that I get to talk about it with other people besides my husband, who is a little sick of B.F. Skinner too.
Thank you. David, did you have any other questions?
There are a lot of questions and comments. So Audrey just sort of mentioned the book. I just wanted to post in the chat, in case anyone didn't know where you can get it. I've just posted a link to MIT Press where there's a few different ways of ordering the book. Audrey, we've already gone past 10 o'clock. Are you happy to hang around a little bit longer to have a look?
I can do a little bit longer. Cool. The dog, bless her heart, is pacing.
Yeah. I'm just going to bring up one of the comments here and just have a look at them. This one in particular, asking all assessment and feedback works from what learners can demonstrate through what they say and do their behavior. Surely we can't tar that as behaviorism.
Why can't we? I mean, I think that that's actually fundamental to Skinner's ideas, right? That this is how we know learning. We can't, you know, we can't despite those brain scans that often show up in like tech entrepreneurs like slides about what the brain looks like in a lecture versus what the brain looks like when it's sleeping. Like we can't actually sort of scan the brain and say, you have a full comprehension of the important thematic ideas in Romeo and Juliet, right? That's not how it works. We do need demonstration. And for Skinner, it wasn't just sort of a physical demonstration, right? It wasn't simply sort of pigeons playing ping pong. It was verbal behavior. I think that this is behaviorism. I think tarring it with behaviorism, so using that word tar, I think is because I think we've, you know, Skinner has become, for reasons that I talk about in the book, for reasons I think that we all know, he's a, you know, there are some political and intellectual problems with B.F. Skinner. But I think that it's behaviorism is so fundamental still to this day. Again, despite the fact that when we read our education psychology textbooks, that there are many chapters after behaviorism, right? The books, in fact, it's another one of those stories that we have that somehow, as you move through psychology, that we can sort of close that chapter and then we're on to cognitive science or neuroscience. I think that is behaviorism, and that's why it matters. And we can't just, we can't just say, oof, makes me feel a bit ooky. So we don't do that anymore.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think that term, like tiring something, and the idea of behaviorism as an inherently negative thing. Psychology and neuroscience have gone through so many phases and constantly adapting and changing, but some of the foundations are still, you know, obviously behaviorism. And I don't know. I think some of our cultural, some of our objection to it is a little bit cultural and very specific to our context. And particularly if, when you talk about, we talk about Skinner not believing in free will or freedom and those sort of things. And again, those kind of concepts, you know, that's not everybody's view of the world. Like freedom isn't actually what some people want. So I guess my question is if we look at behaviorism, some of the positive aspects of behaviorism and the things that still work, is it still valid in any sense? Or is it just that the uses that it's been put to have been very harmful?
I think that is such a great question. I think that, and that's the challenge, I think, that's the sort of political challenge of this, right? I'm going to spoil something from the book again, but, you know, often when we tell the story of Skinner's fall from grace, if you will, often it's told as he wrote this book in which he decried free will, beyond freedom and dignity. And Noam Chomsky, another MIT professor, wrote the scathing review in which he said that this is sort of fascist. It's sort of ludicrous. It's not even science. At best, it's not good science. And at worst, it's fascist, right? And everyone was sort of like, aha, oh my God, Skinner, terrible. We're done with him. But I think that, you know, not everybody read Noam Chomsky's book review, but a lot of people watched a movie that came out the same year that I think actually really did shape their assessment, and that's A Clockwork Orange. You could say that Clockwork Orange doesn't really depict Skinner's radical behaviorism. Of course, the character is not rewarded for good behavior, he's punished for bad behavior. But I think in popular culture, A Clockwork Orange convinced a lot of folks that behavioral engineering was a really bad idea. And it was a bad idea despite a good intention, right? The intention was, let's get rid of crime. Let's rehabilitate criminals. But at the same time, through their loss of free will, through the loss of freedom. But I think that, you know, this is, again, this is a political question. And I think it's incredibly important now when we think of who has, you know, who are the ones who are wielding behavioral engineering, right? Where is the political, where is the economic power that is wielding, and what exactly is the kind of world in which they're trying to engineer? You know, you think about Mark Zuckerberg's vision of the future, for example.
So many comments here I want to pull out. And actually, I'm just going to go back to the questions rather than going through these comments, because I think some of the questions here, this is an interesting one, because you were talking about the internet before and different conceptualizations of the internet. And one of those is connectivism. Where do you see the theoretical practical aspects of connectivism offer something alternative to behaviorist thinking that underpins much of learning design?
Ooh, that is a really good question. And I don't actually have an off the, I love this question and I want to think about it some more. And I don't have an off the cuff response to it. But
I think now, some of these questions I will email to you afterwards.
Yeah,
if you could, we might be able, because there've been a few great, really meaty ones. So yeah.
I feel like someone has assigned me like an essay to write.
Here. Yeah.
And whoever did this, I appreciate it. I'm not being snide or sarcastic. Like, that's actually a great question. And I wanna think some more about that.
Cool. There was another comment here, sort of around the testing and feedback area. You pick out Skinner's two principles: incident feedback is important, and we should adapt to the student pace of learning. The teaching profession agrees that timely feedback is good and a good principle, as is differentiating instruction. Not really a question in there, more of a comment, but yeah.
So I would actually say one point on that is I think that the instant feedback kind of gets oversold. I think that there is something to be said for contemplation. And now, by saying I don't think that instant feedback gets oversold, I'm not saying that like when you get your term paper back, like, you know, 4 weeks after the end of the semester, that's not what I mean. But I do think that the practices, and I say this as a writer, as I say this as someone who thinks a lot about ideas through revision, is I do think that it's worth sitting with ideas for a while. I do think that I think that in some ways, again, when we start to design these things based on certain sets of values, on this idea that we must have instant feedback, then there's a trade-off. And I think when it comes to writing in particular, that it's worth sitting with ideas. It's worth being contemplative. And I don't know that instant feedback on your writing, for example, is necessarily better than feedback that comes down the road. I just think that, you know, some of these things we get a couple of these bees in our bonnet and then we just start designing systems. And I'm not sure that instant feedback and the pace of the student, yeah, differentiating instruction, yes, sure. But we should, you know, we can pause and think about why some of these things matter and how they become, I guess, hard-coded in our technologies in ways that defeat maybe other purposes.
Thank you. And one last question, if you have time, 2 minutes. Cool. Yes. This one here, because personalized, I mean, the history of personalized learning is the sort of subtitle of your book, and we haven't really had any questions about that yet. But in your view, is the idea of personalized learning connected to corporate and neoliberal society? Do we need to look to community rather than individual learning that is not easily? So putting in opposition the idea of, well, it kind of, it crosses over a little bit with individualism, doesn't it?
Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, I think that that's, you know, in the book, I trace where some of these ideas come from through testing. You know, and even by the 1920s in the US, standardized testing was already well underway. There were a lot, students were tested, and standardized testing was incredibly popular. It was already a big business. And so, and many scholars at the time, including Ben Wood, one of the figures that I look at, thought that if we could just get more data, right? If we could just get more data about the students, then we'd be able to, he used the word individualize, but we'd be able to individualize lessons for them. And so, you know, Ben Wood thought, he was a professor at Columbia, researcher at Columbia University. You know, he thought in addition to the standardized testing, intelligence, we could do intelligence testing, we could do aptitude testing, we could do achievement testing, we could do some personality testing. We could just glean as much data as possible from students. And then he was friends with a guy named Thomas Watson, who was the president of a little company called International Business Machines, IBM. And IBM donated to Wood's research center at Columbia a calculating machine so that Wood could sort of crunch the data better on students. And so again, I think that we've had for over 100 years now, or for at least 100 years now, this idea that if we can just glean more data about students, that we'll be able to personalize education. And I think that what that means exactly is, I think, quite different than sometimes what it sounds like to, you know, when people hear, you know, personalization, it does sound more self-fulfilling, more liberatory. But it's really is, I think, how do we, personalization is sort of automation. It's personalized the way in which Facebook is personalized, right? It's personalized the way in which Netflix is personalized. You watch one Disney movie on Netflix and then Netflix personalizes the suggestions and, oh, actually maybe they don't have Disney anymore. Well, you know what I mean. You watch one children's cartoon on Netflix and then Netflix is certain it'll personalize its suggestions to you within the realm of the videos that Netflix has. And of course that's personalized education as well. It might suggest things to you, but they are within the realm of what the curriculum, what other people have specified that the curriculum should be.
Thank you so much, Audrey. I'm going to let you go walk your dog now. and just for everyone else who's still here, we've just got a little feedback survey. If you want to scan that, it will be emailed to you after this session as well. So don't feel like if you can't get your phone out and scan that and leave feedback, you're going to miss out or anything. But I'd just like to thank Audrey so much. And Ashley, I'll let you do the closing sort of remarks and comments and everything.
Well, thank you, Audrey. I just encourage you to keep on researching and writing because we just love your information and we can't wait to read your book. So thanks for joining us today.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for showing up.
Cheers. Thanks, everyone.